This is Thomas Cowan at the Organic Conference in Guelph at the university in 2003. And I think his talk is just as relevant today as it was then.
Pockets on me.
That's technical.
How's that?
Technical.
Fine? So, I was describing last night a little bit of my journey in this, and I was describing that when we graduate from medical school, at least in the United States, we take an oath called the Hippocratic Oath, and part of the oath is to do no harm. Now, all of us, when we take this oath, think of it in the most narrow sense, I think, which is obviously to do no harm to the patient that we're dealing with in front of us. And when I started this 20-some years ago, I had some questions, and I wondered about things. And I wondered if this concept of doing no harm could be widened from just the idea of doing no harm to the individual patient, the individual person sitting in front of me. What if we really took this idea to heart of doing no harm, and we decided to do no harm to the viruses and the bacteria that live in our body and that we say cause our illness? What if we took this idea even further and said we weren't going to do harm to the tumors that may be ravaging and destroying our bodies? What if we took this idea further and try to do no harm to the inflammation that is the characteristic of an illness like rheumatoid arthritis? What would the practice of medicine look like if we really took this idea of doing no harm? Because it's not just the patient then. It's not just the person sitting in front of us. It's these other things. It's the processes going on in our bodies. But it may also be doing no harm to the soil, doing no harm to the earth, doing no harm to the trees, to the birds, to the animals, to the cattle, to the cows, to the fishermen, to the political situation, to the economic situation. And if you start to think like that, and if you wonder along these lines, and you wonder deeply about what the world would look like and what medicine would look like if we took this idea to heart, it immediately got me into thinking, which was an interest of mine all along, what would I tell the patient to do? What kind of way of thinking would I bring to bear in this situation? You see, it then got me clearly into the aspect of diet and the subject of this conference, organic agriculture, which you could say is doing no harm to the environment type of agriculture. That would be one way to describe it. But you get into very practical situations. You see, because I was also faced with people who come to me with tumors that are killing them, with bacterial infections which are threatening their well-being, and whatever philosophy I have, I still have to help them get better. That's the bottom line. So I can't have a do-no-harm medicine that's also ineffective. It needs to be do-no-harm and effective. But what if I came out with a diet that was the best for patients, but the diet said it is impermissible on this diet to eat fish? What would happen to the tens of millions of fishermen around the world who sustainably make their living generation after generation, harvesting and making available the food from the oceans? What would it be if I said, as some people say, dairy products aren't good for us, therefore we don't drink milk, and that's the best diet for patients, for people? But what would happen to the cows? What would happen to the dairy farmers, the individuals who make their honest living caring for their cows, caring for the fertility of the soil, et cetera, et cetera? So this idea of doing no harm medicine gets you into huge areas of philosophical and practical thinking. So I had to come up with a plan that I could use for my patients. And I set out to see, well, let's start with the food. since I like to eat. It's a wonderful way to relate to the world. And I was always, I'm a foodie, and so interested in food. And around this time, years and years ago, 20 years ago, I started asking the question, then what do we tell the people to eat? And at that point, I ran into the work of Weston Price. Now, as a little bit of an introduction here, Weston Price was a dentist who lived and worked in the 20s and 30s in a clinic in Cleveland. He was the president of the American Dental Association Research Division. And he was well known in the research world of dentistry, as well as any dentist is well known, which isn't very much. And he did something which I think is right along the lines that I'm talking about, not maybe in the same frame, but he asked the question, which is a huge and radical question for his time and for our time, is there anybody out there who's healthy? Now, that's the idea that I was coming to, because if we are not going to attack sickness, if we're not going to attack bacteria or tumors, the other side of that is we must work, I must work as a doctor, to promote health. If you have a tumor, I promote health. And my thinking is, if you promote health in everything, in the person, in the cows, in the soil, in the economics, in the fishermen, in the grass, all those things are the same. Eating healthy cows are the best way to eat cows. Eating healthy carrots is the best way to eat carrots. And that there is no difference. There is no such thing as having a system of having cows that are unhealthy in eating them and maintaining health. That, in my way of thinking, wouldn't fly. So Price asked the question, is there anybody out there with perfect health? Because if there were, he wanted to see how did they do it. Not how they prevented disease, but how did they attain this perfect health? And it's interesting because really only a dentist can do that. If you were a gastroenterologist and you said, I want to see if there's people out there with perfect livers, how would you measure it? How would you measure people with perfect spleens? If you were a hematologist, there's no such thing as perfect blood. So you couldn't do that in that realm. But as a dentist, you can set up some parameters, and the parameters that Price said was, a perfect teeth is going into a village, looking at the people. Nobody in the village has orthodontic problem. They all have room in their mouth for all 32 of their teeth. They have less than 1% cavities throughout their life. And they never lose their teeth due to illness, due to dental disease. That's the definition of perfect teeth. He wondered whether if people had perfect teeth, perfect dental health, might they also be healthy in other ways? Now, at this point, I like to stop and ask, is there anybody out there with perfect teeth? Meaning, room in your mouth for all of your teeth, 32 teeth to come in, and no cavities throughout your life, no loss of teeth. Raise your hand. I've probably spoken this, asked this question to now and looked at people. I worked in emergency rooms and looked in everybody's teeth. At least 20,000 people, and there's a couple hands, but basically three people I've met. So if this is an illness, this is an illness of which the incidence is 100% in the Western population. The question that Price asked, is this the normal situation for human beings? I have to step down here a little bit to do this next part. But lo and behold, he found 14 groups of people throughout the world. They were white people and black people and yellow people and purple people and lots of different kinds of people. There's people from Australia. Just take a look at their faces and their teeth. This is different than the National Geographic take on this. These are people from other aspects. He would go with his count. He would measure the teeth. He would look to see if anybody had orthodontic problems, anybody with teeth coming in the wrong way. He would count up. And to get in the book, which he called Nutrition and Physical Degeneration, which is here if you want to look at it, he found these 14 groups, and they fit these criteria. There's people from New Zealand. This kind of study, as far as I know, has never been done before, and I don't think it could be done since. Here's people from Melanesia. And I could go on and on and on, these 14 groups. Swiss people, Gaelic people, people from Chimu culture in Peru. That's what they look like. Turn the lights on. So, he was able to find these people. He was able to figure out what they eat and follow them through the years. And that's what, as I said, pointed out this book, Nutrition and Physical Degeneration by Weston Price. It's all about what he found. Now, he helped us eat even further, because over the next 20 years, he continued to follow these people to see what happened to them when they started to eat what we call, what he called foods of modern commerce, or Western food. And what happened? Now, there is no situation where the only thing in life that changes is just the food. But as far as he could tell, that was the basic thing that changed. They didn't start exercising less. They didn't change their religion. They didn't convert to Buddhism. They didn't do lots of things. They just, even in one generation, started introducing the foods of modern commerce, Western food. And this is what he found. These are, the top are the old-fashioned, so-called. We don't use the word primitive anymore, but the people who were eating the original diet. And the people on the bottom, I hope you can all see this, are the people who were born after a change in diet, sort of white man's food. This is the same thing. These are people from somewhere, Switzerland. And again, the people before, perfect teeth, no cavities, no dental problems, change in diet, nothing else changed in their life. They didn't move, they didn't do anything different except change their diet, and you see what happens to them. You see this in the Australian Aboriginal group. You see it somewhere, India Indians, and these were Africans. Especially take a look at this fellow on the lower right, and to see what happened when people changed their diet. This is one of the clearest and most important and most visually striking views of this situation, I think, that has ever been done. Now, the question, of course, is why? What happened? Well, Price spent the next number of years trying to study that. First, let me just, sometimes if people want to describe, what do they see? And in a group like this, in spite of that I like to have audience participation to keep you awake, I'm going to not harass you and just tell you. The reason that Price found that this happened was we have mandible bones that are like two flat plates like this. And if they are strong and healthy, the teeth come in, I hope you can all see this, in a sort of straight pattern with plenty of room, including room for all the wisdom teeth. What he found was with this change in diet, due to causes which I'll describe in a minute, the thickness of the bones became less, thinner by sometimes 20 to 40%. Now, it's as if you had a house and you built it with strong beams, and the house was flat and the roofs were strong, and then you built the next house and you used 20%, 40% less material in the wood, less strength in the wood, and as you can imagine, the wood would start to bow, and you would have teeth, mandibles that look, I'm exaggerating, like this. And if you could imagine, then the teeth come in like this, and if you look at some of our modern children, the teeth come in this way and all different ways, etc., like that. And so you can see that the physical deterioration of the mandible structure resulted in this different facial configuration and the crowding of the teeth. When you look at these, and I could put them up again, But the amazing thing is all these original people look alike. They have wide, broad faces, nostrils that are wide, healthy, wide-spaced teeth, and they all look like brothers and sisters. Beautiful, happy, some of the healthiest people that have ever been studied. The newer people, you can see the face narrow because the bones bow, the nostrils become narrow, there's no room for the teeth to come in, and their resistance to dental illness is impaired, so they're full of cavities, etc. Now, if you think of this from what this crowd of people, what this room of people would look like with no restorative dentistry, think about it for a minute. Some of you wouldn't be here because we know that suicide, the number one cause of suicide is chronic dental pain. So some of you wouldn't be here. The others of you would be missing lots of different teeth. You would be in pain with gum abscesses and some ways not the most appealing looking people, and quite in contrast to how you are right now. So this would be a whole different world. And if you were living in a situation where there was no dentist, this is a big deal, to not have dental problems. In fact, to be healthy. Now, the next question that I like to ask people is, we know that this happened in the jaw bones, in the mandibles. How many people think the only bones in the body that are 20 to 40% less are the mandibles, and the femur, and the hips, and the chest cavity? All that is normal, but just happened in the mandible. Nobody thinks that, because nobody would raise their hand for such a ludicrous idea. So this is not just a dental problem. It's like when people ask me, do you think I'm going to have osteoporosis? I don't need a bone density test. I ask, are you an American or Canadian? Yes, yes, you do. Because you were born with 20 to 40% less bone thickness than what I would say is the normal human being. These are the normal human beings. These people can see the moons of Jupiter with their naked eye. We have trouble seeing the exit sign without our glasses. These people have been studied for colon cancer, none. Heart disease, none. Arthritis, none. Longevity, amongst the highest in the world. So, if we ask ourselves, not in a disease model, how do we treat disease, but how do we promote health? This is one of the most fundamental studies that I know of in the history of the world that points the way. So when people ask me, well, Dr. Cowan, do you think it's, I think human beings shouldn't drink milk. Milk is for baby cows. What do you think? Well, there's different pro and con on that. But I say some of these people, are like four or six of the groups, had as one of their main sources of food dairy products. They were cattle raisers. They did it in very particular ways, which I'll talk about in a minute. But it's hard for me to square knowing that there are people who have perfect health who got there by drinking grass-fed milk that was unpasteurized, and the strategy of the farming techniques is to increase the fat content of the milk, and then they culture it. In fact, one of the shocking things about this is if you read Price and you read the story of these diets, they all eat the same food. They all had one diet. They all followed one set of rules about food. They, of course, ate different in particular. The Gaelics ate fish and soaked oats and greens and cream. But if you know food groups, those are the three food groups. Animal foods, soaked, cultured, sprouted grains, and some vegetables. And furthermore, what you learn, which can be a shock to some people's system, unfortunately, I apologize for that, is if you said, what was the one food that none of these people could do without? What was the one food that their whole agricultural system, which was the key to this, was all about? And instead of asking you, I will say the answer is animal fats. The more they could eat, the better. Now, that's not exactly what we learn in medical school. But that's what we learn if we clear our head and think, what did Price actually find with these people? What are some of the details of this? They were very strict about how they raised their animals, how they caught their fish, how they prepared and grew their grains. And these are all the rules of good nutrition, which I can tell you, I don't really have time to go through all those. I know you're all sitting there thinking, well, what did they eat? Come on, you know, tell me. But the rules are in this book. It's called Nourishing Traditions by Sally Fallon. She was the director of the Price-Pottinger Foundation and now the Weston Price, where I'm part of. And this book is a cookbook of what these people ate. So get the cookbook, follow them, and I'll talk about it a little bit. But the next thing I want to say is that Price took this, worked with some of his buddies, especially a guy named Francis Pottinger, and they wanted to see what would happen to people, to animals, if they changed their diet, to see what happens. So they mostly worked with cats, and it's in a book called Pottinger's Cats, because they wanted to see if there was any lawfulness to this, any regularity of the pattern, any predictability to what happens. And, you know, by the way, both of my father and my grandfather, my Canadian side, were both dentists. And I have often asked dentists, why is it that people, everybody today, has crooked teeth? Nobody today, no child today, practically, is born with enough room in their mouth for their teeth to come in. Well, it's because when Italians marry Irish people, then they have bad teeth. It's a genetic problem. Mind you, these happened in the same generation, even in the same family, once they changed their teeth. Now, I can buy that when Irish people marry Italians, they fight a lot. But I'm not sure if that's the cause of their poor teeth. Anyways, Price and Pottinger wanted to find out what happens to animals, humans. Is there a regularity to this pattern? And this is another important aspect of this, because they studied cats. And they fed them a diet of raw milk, that's unpasteurized milk, raw meat, and cod liver oil. And these cats were healthy generation after generation. They had no deterioration of their bony structure, no allergies, no infections, no chronic disease. Now, some people say, yeah, I went to Dr. Cowan, I heard a lecture, and he told me to eat raw milk, raw meat, and cod liver oil. I did, but only if you're a cat. That's not the diet for humans, that's the diet for cats. But then they said, let's interrupt this and change the diet, just like the diet was changed for these people. And they, for instance, pasteurized the milk, or cooked the meat, or omitted the cod liver oil. And the amazing thing is, if you read the research done in the 40s and 50s, a very predictable pattern started to emerge. They would do things like feed these cats for a year in this so-called altered diet, and then they would feed them on the regular diet and let them breed and see what happens. The first generation, as you can predict, the bony structure deteriorated. They had bad teeth and occlusion problems, and they were susceptible to infections. Price thought that was because of the alteration of the vitamin A, which is this sort of anti-infection nutrient in the original diet. Vitamin A is made from carotenes, which is made from cows eating grass. So cows that eat grass, cows that are in the sun make vitamin D, which then allows the minerals like calcium and phosphorus, etc., to be absorbed, etc., etc. But I always hate to get into the gory vitamin-like details of this, because I still want you to think about the whole picture. So generation one was dental problems and infections, just like the people we saw here. Then he bred those cats. Generation two, the altered generation two, they began to have allergies and endocrine problems. Now, if you think of it from at least American, I'm used to talking about American, 100% of Americans have disease level one. Disease level one doesn't recede, it just continues on. The incidence of people with endocrine problems, hypothyroidism, adrenal problems, etc., etc., and allergies in the United States is 40 to 50%. So that's what happens in generation two. Generation three, you start seeing autoimmune disease, cancer, diabetes, all the chronic diseases that we know, and we know the incidence of those, including diabetes, arthritis, high blood pressure, coronary artery disease, cancer, etc., is somewhere 40 to 50% in the United States at this time of people suffering with this. And again, the cats and the people had none of this. The fourth generation, if you let them keep going, it's too bad I can't make you guess on this, but they begin to have what they describe in Pottinger's books as, quote, sociological problems. Or people who were unable to get along with each other. Or what we sometimes erroneously refer to as mental illness. Now, of course, we in the United States have no trouble getting along with people. Except sometimes, of course. And the other thing that happened, which is the most interesting thing of all, is infertility. At a certain point in this nutrition and physical degeneration scenario, the animals simply said, not the right word, but experienced the phenomena of we can't breed anymore, this has gone too far. And the incidence of infertility of the typical American couple at age 25 to 30 at this point is now 30%. We don't know what happens in generation five, except all these things keep going. And I think that you could make a case that this is a serious problem. If you alter the diet, you have a predictable pattern, which we are seeing now, the beginning of the fourth generation, of the wholesale change in American agriculture and the wholesale change in the American eating patterns. And we are seeing this pattern right before our eyes. And those of us who read the literature knew it was coming. Now, just as an interesting thing about this, if you would take a guess as to take these cats, give them 1 year of altered food, put them back on the right food, how many generations does it take until they become normal again? The answer is seven. So it takes quite a while with cats to reverse this nutrition and physical degeneration phenomena. It's happening. It somehow gets into the being of these animals and keeps going. Now, I think I'm with everybody here so far. Now, this talk had something to do with the scientific explanation, if there is such a thing, to this phenomena. I would like to give you another theory that helps to explain the strategy of these people. I've said some of it so far. They had rules of food, and it includes the subject of this conference, organic agriculture, but it's organic agriculture to the max. But it was really, if you think about it, everything they said and wrote about was how to foster the healthiest cows, the healthiest plants, the healthiest social structures, the healthiest soil. That was their question that ran through all these. The healthiest sustainable fishing techniques, which is different than farmed fish. And it's different than a lot of the things that we do today. But that was their question, which is very much in line with what I started this, which is there is no possibility to have a healing system where the cows get sicker and we get healthier. It simply doesn't work like that. This is a win across the board situation on the political and economic and soil and the cows, etc. Now, so they had all these techniques for doing that, and I would encourage those of you who are interested in the health of the animals, the health of their soil, etc., to look at what they did, and I'm interested in the health of the people. Now, what do we know about this from a so-called modern scientific point of view? What happens? There's another phenomena that I want to just touch on briefly, and again, I don't have so much time to go into all these things in depth, but it's another of the interesting strategies that I think has a lot to do with the transition from organic agriculture to other kinds of agriculture, or an agriculture based on the health of every living thing and every inorganic thing to an agriculture based on something else. And that's this whole problem of what's now called Syndrome X, or some people call Metabolic X Syndrome. Now, how many people know what I'm talking about with this? Not so many. So what this syndrome is it was coined in 1980s by a man from Stanford who said, well, a lot of Americans, they have high blood pressure and diabetes, and they're overweight, and they have coronary artery disease, and they have arthritis. So usually we give them their arthritis medicine, their diabetes medicine, their heart transplant, their blood pressure medicine, and I can't remember what the first one was, but there's got to be something for that too. And they're depressed because they don't feel well, so we give them Prozac. Now that's what I mean by medicine that focuses on there's something wrong, I'm going to fix it, not on encouraging what could be healthy in this person. So this man asked the question, is it possible they have one disease with six different manifestations? And he started to look at it, and he found out that there is a hormone called insulin, which I'm sure you've all heard of, which if you inject insulin into animals, they get arthritis, cancer, diabetes, they get overweight, they get heart disease, they retain fluid and have high blood pressure. And so they estimate that 50 to 70 million Americans have hyperinsulinemia or too much insulin in their blood, metabolic X syndrome. And they have all these manifestations of this disease. How do you get hyperinsulinemia, too much insulin in your blood? It's very simple. Because insulin's function in the human being, or in any animal, is to lower the blood sugar. The fundamentals of a balanced diet is you eat proteins and fats as much as you want, especially the fats, especially grass-fed butter and healthy fish, and CLAs from meat, etc., etc. You eat the protein according to your needs. If you eat too much, you'll feel sick and throw up. And you eat sugar, which also goes by the name of carbohydrates, depending on how much activity you do, because sugar is the fuel for activity. Now, that means it's not the same for everybody. If you run a marathon, that may take 300 grams of carbohydrates to fuel that activity. If you sit on the couch all day, that only takes less fuel. You might move around a little bit, but it doesn't take so much. That takes 60 grams of sugars. Sugars in carrots, sugars in grains, sugars in beets, sugars in candy bars, sugars in fruit juice, it doesn't matter. The body sees how much sugar. And if there's too much for the activity, you make insulin to store it. Insulin says, store as fat. You can't get overweight without too much insulin, because without insulin, you will starve to death. Insulin says, too much sugar, store as fat. In the meantime, retain fluid, have high blood pressure, coronary artery disease, destroys your joints, and it fuels the growth of cancer cells. So what's a balanced diet? Is eating the amount of carbohydrates, sugars, depending on your activity level. If you eat 300...
For the conclusion of this presentation, please turn the cassette over and depress the play button.